It's just a box of Kleenex. Isn't it, Mike? Oh, you're going to be on the edge of your seat to wait to hear about this, aren't you? So our text today, in the Gospel of Mark, it's important that we remember where we are. We're in the Gospel of Mark. You know Mark is the one who, if Hemingway had been writing then, it would have been his gospel. Cut, short, dry, right to the point. Right, and then. We do this. It takes this amount of space for Mark to say what Matthew would say in this amount of space, right? Different ways of writing. That's cool. One of the ways that Mark helps us understand who this person was who walked the face of the earth 2,000 years ago is to tell stories inside of stories. So today we have a story about Jesus teaching with authority, the people. And we don't actually hear what Jesus is saying. We hear the reaction of the people, right? The only time we hear what Jesus is saying is when we have this one call out his name. What have you come to do with us, Jesus of Nazareth? Have you come to destroy us? I know who you are, the Holy One of God. The demon calls Jesus the Holy One of God. Even the demon can see this one is the Holy One of God. And all that Jesus says, be silent and come out of him. So Mark is using this story about getting rid of demons, and that's not the unusual part. The unusual part is not that, because there were lots of people casting out demons when Jesus was around. It was no big deal. And he did it the same way they all did it. It was no big deal. What was a big deal was how he was teaching them. He was teaching them from his heart. He was teaching them in a way that connected so that they understood that they were heard, so that they understood what Jesus was talking about. It was something he understood. It was something they understood. It was part of their life. It wasn't some grandiose lecture on the plane of theory. It was down to earth. You know the parables that we hear. They're about farmers and wine growers and fishermen. Right? It's about what those people knew in first century Palestine, at least the people that Jesus walked among. They were amazed at how he was present to them. Now, I was struck by the fact that this text from Mark, which helps us understand the importance of Jesus' role as teacher in this gospel, connects with what I said yesterday at the annual meeting. You remember the annual meeting where we elected people and passed it, and there really weren't people throwing things. I lied about that. Now, the thing about barking at Mike, I didn't lie about, so you can believe me most of the time. Just when I say things are being thrown around, I can't believe that. So I want to read you another text or part of another text. This is from the Gospel of John, the Dickens author of the Gospels. If you can say it in 20 words, say it in 40. And I love Dickens, you know I love Dickens. So, Mary has come to the tomb. She's in the garden, she's outside the tomb after Jesus has been crucified. His body is gone, and and she is distraught. And she is standing outside of the tomb weeping. And someone says to her, "Why are you weeping, woman?" She believes it's the gardener. She's in the garden, it's gotta be the gardener. It's not the gardener. Jesus says, "Mary." All he says is her name. And she gets it. She turned to him and she said in Hebrew, "Rabboni," which means teacher. She saw him and recognized him as her teacher, the one who knew how to touch her heart and to speak what was true to her and to those who followed him. And what did Mary want to do? This is where the Kleenex comes in. Oh, she didn't need a Kleenex. No, she was not interested in Kleenex. She wanted to grab him by the ankles and not let him go. And he said to her, "Do not hold on to me." So I was telling the folks gathered yesterday at the annual meeting, you're not going to want to miss the next one, you know. I was telling the folks at the annual meeting that this past week, I had this image. It wasn't a dream, you know, I dream a lot. This wasn't a dream, this was daytime. And in this image, it was Mary outside the tomb. And Jesus saying, "Why are you weeping?" And I was Mary, wanting to hold on to Pilgrim Church. Not wanting to let go. Wanting to keep it the way it has been since the summer of 2010. Wanting to hang on. That's when the Kleenex came out. And I wasn't the only one weeping. Nor will I be the only one weeping. I get that. You and I have been together this awesome time. We have walked together. We have argued together. We have worked together. We've gotten donut burns together. We've marched together. We've sat in endless meetings together. We've done the work. And don't forget about the crop walk. We've done that too. So many things that we've done together that have filled me up. And I think they've filled many of you up as well. You have been my teacher. And I believe I've been your teacher. We can only be a teacher when we're open to being taught, right? We have been on this journey, and it has been a good one. And my heart wishes it weren't ending. But I know that it is right. I know that this is time. As I was saying yesterday, at Christmas time, Jim gave me a tricycle. I don't have enough balance to ride a bike. And while I can still preach and not be able to balance, although you might have noticed once or twice when I actually almost tripped, and that was not just tripping, that was losing my balance. There are worse things than losing your balance, right? There's the not remembering the stuff you're supposed to remember, and so far I'm being able to remember. What I know is this. I want to go out on top. I don't want to wait until you're saying, "Oh my God, is she still here?" I want to go out when I still remember most of your names most of the time. I want to go out when I still remember what the text is that we're doing this week and how it fits with what we did last week and what we're going to do next week. I need to go now. Oh, I wouldn't go. And it isn't that I don't go with a deep amount of sadness. Can you imagine what it's like to be a pastor in Pilgrim Church right now? For me? Maybe not for somebody else. I love our wonkiness. I love how we're just out there. I love that I don't have to think about what I'm doing when I'm out in the community. Can somebody come over here and sit with Elaine? I need somebody over here sitting with Elaine. Yeah, move, thank you, and here's the Kleenex. It's okay if we're all crying. It's okay if we're all yelling. It's okay if we're just sitting there. Next week, on Saturday, we're going to come together, hopefully with the nursery school, and celebrate this time of Lent together. Church leaders have agreed to speak briefly. None of them are Baptist preachers, so we know when you say 2 to 3 minutes, it's going to be okay. It's an important time for us to come together, to celebrate what we've done, and to commit to a future that lives into this church's calling as people of God. We gather at 3 o'clock. I hope you'll be here. And on Sunday morning, November 4th. Oh, I'm not even here. I'm gone. Oh, I've extended. Oh, that's one way to look at it, Maureen. The choir is going to sing for me if you know that. Before the last time I preach here, the choir is going to sanctify me. And then we're going to do communion. We're going to gather for communion because we know how to do communion. And then Reverend Dr. Verdi Power is going to help us. First, we will have this liturgy of farewell for Jim, who has been my rock and my salvation for all these years. He will be leaving the church so he can be by my side. And then Verdi Power will lead the liturgy that offers me the opportunity to let go of you as my congregation and invites you to let go of me as your pastor. It's a really important transition. When I walk into the sanctuary next Sunday, I walk in as your pastor. And when I walk out, I will no longer be your pastor. We will live through this. We will all go on to thrive. I know we will. currency. Jesus was a teacher. He taught me. Out in the world, in whatever ways we're called to be out in the world. Some of us are good at marching. Some of us are good at art. Some of us are good at writing. Some of us are good at just being present. Jesus taught us how to do that. And he also taught us that it isn't up to just one of us, or two of us, or this whole congregation. It's up to us to do our small part, but do it well. And to thank God for the opportunity to do what we're called to do. I have no idea what next Sunday is going to look like. I know it's going to be beautiful. And I know it's going to be lots of music. And I know we're going to be lifted up by that. And I am grateful. Because I know next Sunday, I'm going to need to be lifted up. Let us walk together while we can. Even if we're crying, even if we're yelling, even if we're saying, no, I don't want Kleenex, let us walk together. And when Jim and I step out, you keep walking together. I know you will. I love you more than the whole.